Welcome everybody to the Fantasy Golf Insider webcast and podcast. I'm Jeff Bergerson, joined as always by my partner, Zachary Turcotte. We're with FantasyGolfInsider.com, where if you are not a premium member, you are not getting all of the information and content you need to be a winning fantasy golf and DFS golf player. Find us at on Twitter at @FantasyGolfers. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel. Just click that little subscribe button underneath the video here so you know exactly when our videos are coming out each week. This webcast is also available in podcast form on iTunes and Stitcher. And finally, if you would do us a favor right now, is go give us a good review on iTunes. It would help us rank up there a lot. Oh yeah, and one more thing. If you're that one person on every one of our videos who clicks the thumbs down, go suck a tailpipe. Because I know it's the same person. It's always one. It's never like five or ten. It's always one. So some jackass is sitting out there saying, I don't like these guys. I'm going to give them a thumbs down. Honestly, have you ever clicked the thumbs down on a video?
No.
Just don't watch it. Why do you click thumbs down? I just don't get it.
I'm sure it's a competitor. Somebody out there.
I'm gonna get these guys. I'm gonna give them a thumbs down. Right. They never say anything. They just give you the thumbs down. I don't like you guys. I watch the whole video every week, but
as
I don't like it.
Plenty of jerk offs in the industry, right? So nothing new there. You know who you are.
Anyways, let's talk about some people who do like us. Those who won a lot of money last week, which was a lot of Team FGI. We got tons of emails, tons of tweets. Our folks absolutely crushed cash games, and we told them to go heavy on cash games. Yeah. I even put it in my GPP article.
We had 16 of 17 cash game picks that made it through the cut, which, I mean, it's the Masters, so you expect that, but that's why we say, particularly for the
sure.
Masters, to load up on cash. So as long as you didn't go across the board with Tyrrell Hatton, you probably won most of your cash games for the week. We had Ricky, we had Rose, we had Kuchar.
Yep.
So we had all the big players that were up there.
I even had a cash game team that won with Ty Hatton.
Yes.
It was possible.
That happened too. Yep, exactly.
Congrats to a few people. I'll give shout outs to Mike V, Mark Gaw, Rob Robertson, Ted Sims, Dave Coleman, and last but not least, the FGI member who took the highest in the Millionaire Maker was Brent Epstein.
Yep,
right?
I was emailing with him the night before the contest, going over strategy.
Oh, nice.
With him to decide on what to do now that, you know, once DJ had left the event. So it was pretty cool. He was actually, when I looked at on Friday morning, I believe it was, he was actually at the top for a little while. So he had the $1 million next
Sweet.
To his name, and the logo was up there at the top. I thought, well, I know this probably won't last today, but still kind of fun, kind
that
of exciting.
Cool.
Yeah, I mean, the Millionaire Makers are always great. They're almost impossible to win. You know, as soon as Kuchar hit the hole in one, we knew
if you didn't have Kuchar, you weren't in a million.
Right, the first 100 or so teams in the rankings there were going to be Matt Kuchar teams picking up all those extra points right there. So, but it's neat to watch. I think my best team peaked out at like 30th or 31st. Midway through Saturday, and that I kind of marked that moment in time. And I said, well, it's downhill from here. And sure enough, I was right. So it's always an exciting contest, and Brent did great. We'll get him out. We'll get him out some FGI
some gear.
Gear for the week.
Yeah, and if you want to use the FGI avatar on DK, and you end up doing some good things, we'll send you out some gear. So everyone who wants to do it, we'll send it to you. Just email us, and we'll send it out. So
for sure.
The Masters.
It was an exhausting week.
Started
man.
Not so well.
I mean, from beginning to end, you know, we worked so hard to get the research done, to think about what we're going to do. You know, I even proclaimed on the show, hey, I'm all in DJ. But I mean, even still writing it, it's tough to finally to make that commitment, because I don't really go 100% in on players all that often. And so when I finally got done, posted it Wednesday morning, I felt very proud of myself. It was a solid 7,000 words of comments. The one I try to make my absolute best all year, because I know we've got the most eyes on it. People are looking forward to it. I take a little nap for a few hours. I wake up, I look at my phone. DJ has hit the steps. He's hurt his back. He's questionable to play. And I just wanted to cry, smash my phone, crawl under a rock. I mean, it was pretty. And then the rest of the day, emails, Twitter messages.
What do you do?
What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? We try to give you our best solution. I said, well, I won't have them on any more than like 5% to 10% tops out of all my GPP. Yep. Obviously, yank him from cash. There were a handful of people that actually left him in cash games, which for the life of me,
they didn't listen to my email because on Wednesday understand. Night I sent out the email and said he's got to be out from cash. Get he just has to be. And then GPPs, he's got to be out too unless you are willing to take that risk.
And the worst part was he had the late tee time. He didn't have the So you see him going. As soon as you see him out on the range, you're like, this isn't this. Now I wish it was just 0%.
Yeah,
because he's not looking good at all. He can't even bend down to pick up the ball. Put it on the tee. It was an absolute mess because I really didn't want to play either Rory or Spieth. But the whole strategy that I had set out was predicated on playing DJ. So to go back and reorders, I had a lot of Ricky.
All the lineups were built.
Yeah, I had a lot of Ricky. I had a lot of Rose up at the top. I had a lot of Rom. And that's kind of what I wanted, to surround him, those guys with DJ. And then we'll fill in with Kisner and Hadwin, who I knew would be highly owned, but were cheap enough. And you had to find a couple of those guys that were cheap enough that you could overweight in order to make all of that work. And then I ended up sliding a few shares to Spieth, a few shares to Roy, although what happened to those guys this weekend wasn't all that unpredictable.
No.
I didn't think.
Which is why I wanted to go. I was all in 100% on DJ too.
I mean, I think what we saw it out of Spieth. The one area where he's really weak right now is off the tee. He gets himself into trouble off the tee over and over and over again. And it just takes a couple of bad situations and a couple bad holes at Augusta where things blow up and it's all over. And then same thing. I mean, Rory, we've seen it. He's just still not quite there with his short game.
It's
killing him right now. Yeah, exactly. And so I could see both of those guys were going to struggle. And when we saw the push out of Spieth, I thought, all right, he's locked in now. Mm-hmm. Now I'm glad I have those shares. And then Sunday rolled around, and it wasn't just the one hole on 12 where he went in the water. I mean, it was from the very beginning. He wasn't hitting greens. He wasn't leaving himself close putts. He was missing those six-footers, seven-footers that he usually just knocks in. Without a lot of questions. So that was a little frustrating. Was in pretty good position for a lot of the GPPs that I put together, because although I did not like Sergio to win, and I'm still really shocked that he did win, he showed up so well in our model.
Yeah.
And his price was so cheap that I knew, I said, well, he's going to make the cut and he's playing pretty well. I could see him threatening a top 10. So 8,300, I'll take some shares there. So I was on him there, which definitely did help. You know, Rose obviously played really well, so that helped out. Fowler hurt the last day by completely falling apart, but I had a lot of Casey in there as well. So, I mean, overall, you know, I ended up ahead for the week, but I still kept looking back the whole time. Like, if DJ had played, I'm pretty certain this would have been a very big week. I think
I'm confident he would have won.
Because when you saw two and three there as far as Spieth and McIlroy, you can see his game is much better.
It is that much better.
And I don't know how much this back injury now is going to hurt. I mean, back injuries are so bad.
I know.
And he's a taller player as it is. You may expect him probably to have
a lot of
torque
on his back with his motion, too. He puts a lot of strain on it.
You probably expect something like that in his career. So you just hope it's not so serious that it becomes chronic or affects him for the rest of the season. I don't know. So it was an okay event. I ended up, I had a little for cash, I had a little bit for GPPs. You know, I had moments where I was way ahead and then moments where I was about even. So I was happy to come out a little bit ahead, but I feel like we were right there with our picks this week in terms of probably what could have happened, but we'll never really know now.
Sergio can thank you personally.
I know, I sent the big tweet out that as soon as he got behind the tree on 13, I just said he can't win here. And I was saying it all week, he can't do it. And then he miraculously got out of there on 13 and got up and down and made par. And then Rose started a little bit of it. Rose choked on about a 3-foot birdie putt on 13.
You can't say choke.
You can't say that.
It
doesn't exist in professional
sports,
right?
No, you can't say choke.
He played good all day. He just so it got tied. And then on 15, when Sergio hit a real nice eagle putt, and then Rose right back with the birdie, and then they go to 16. Sergio did get a little bit of the yips there.
Oh, yeah.
He left it short after Rose sank his putt. And I still think Rose may have torqued his back a little bit on 15.
Well, sure, he was.
When he came up.
Yeah, he was stretching it.
So that didn't look too good. And then 17, he hit the rough tee shot. And then the approach to the bunker. I always get a kick out of the announcers. I tweeted about that, too. And somebody, of course, everybody's got to answer every little tweet. I mean, it's just like a little observation, but people have to answer like every tweet, because you hear Faldo in there, and he's, and Faldo says, oh, that's not a not too difficult of a bunker shot.
Right.
Like, you're up one on 17 trying to win your first green jacket, and you're about 80 feet from the pin on Augusta's greens. Every bunker shot there is
probably pretty difficult.
It's probably pretty difficult. And then he went on to bogey the hole, and it was tied up. And and then 18, we had the drama on 18 where they...
Rose handed it to him, though.
In the playoffs? Because Sergio tried to gag it. Sergio really did gag it away.
For sure.
It was a five-footer on 18, and he choked. And I put that on Twitter. And I stand behind that. The idiot out there who wanted to disagree with me about it, the very big name in our industry who just chose to disagree about it, you're wrong. There are such things as chokes in professional sports. Gary Anderson in 1998 hit every field goal extra point all season. He missed a 38-yarder in the NFC Championship game that would have sent the Vikings to the Super Bowl. That's a choke. Bill Buckner, ground ball, two outs, 1986, ball goes through his legs. That is a choke.
Yeah, but he made every other play in the World
Series,
though.
He made every other play, 95% of it. He played great. The 2003 Cubs, they're up 3-1 against the Florida Marlins. They're trying to break their curse. They gag it away. That is a choke. There are such things as choke. Chris Webber, 93. Timeout. Not nowhere. There are chokes in professional sports.
You revel in it, though.
Oh, I revel in it. Exactly.
You are a reveler.
Especially when I have money on the other guy that he's playing
against. How dare you root against Sergio?
I think we both still make our money in this industry from betting on the outcome of how players perform. But especially when I have money on Rose. He was in our six-pack last week. So, yes. It was kind of heartbreaking. I was excited because when Sergio stepped up to that putt from 5 feet, I thought, well, this is a done deal. He's not missing this now. And then when he gave us life again, I thought
I did not think that.
And once he missed it, I thought, well, there's no way now that Sergio's going to win this play.
Well, but then Rose, you know, hits it. Hammered
it into the tree.
And then I was baffled by his decision to just chip out. I would thought, like Faldo said, let's try and do something low under the tree limb, get it up to the bunker and go up and down.
Once he
chipped out, Sergio had been, his approach shots were locked in. I thought that was kind of just handing it over to him.
And Rose almost
and if Rose makes that
putt, then Sergio's not
I stand by that. But he made that birdie putt. Well, there's no pressure.
It was a two putt.
None.
It was a two putt. Right. All he had to do was two putt.
Just don't race it past.
I mean, it was an awesome, awesome event. Like, I was enthralled from beginning to end, especially on Sunday. It's great when you get that kind of leaderboard and it's that close. And there's so many turns of momentum going back and forth. I mean, we haven't had that much excitement in most of the events so far this season. It's been like chalk, chalk, chalk. You know, not a lot of real exciting finishes. And then when you get the best tournament of the year and you end up getting one of the best finishes out there, it'll be one that you can watch again and again in terms of the highlights and still marvel at and be excited about. I mean, there was just so many moments where when Sergio was off in the woods where he thought this could have been a lot worse on 10 and 11. You know, there's the one there where he hit it like between, there's like a 2-inch spot.
Oh, yeah.
Where he hit it right between the branches where that catches a little higher, a little lower. That's
amazing.
On the ground.
Yep.
That's a mess. So, yeah, as always, I mean, with Augusta, you get so many awesome storylines just from day 1, 2, 3, and 4. You know, Charlie Hoffman gets out of the gates. I'm ready to just strangle myself.
It took a tweet from me,
Tweets from us to bring
him
down.
I said, what size jacket are you wearing, Charlie? 46?
And immediately had three straight bogeys.
I mean, outrageous.
It really is powerful, the kind of things that
people don't believe it.
The things that we can do. I mean, when you say Sergio can't win and he hasn't been inside.
I didn't say that. I won't say I liked him to win. I liked him a lot. And I didn't think that he couldn't not win.
Yeah.
You just see guys pop up now that, we said it, you know, people have been saying about Dustin Johnson, he won, and now Sergio. I just think in golf, eventually it's going to happen if you're up near the top every single time.
Except for Lee Westwood.
It will never happen.
It will never happen for Lee Westwood.
He's just not that good, though.
Well, geez, I mean,
at the Masters, it's
the Masters.
Crazy.
Yeah, I mean, even you have to just throw him in. I hated it this last week. I was like, I'll throw in 10% shares.
Doesn't it?
I have no idea how this is going to work out. And sure enough, he's right there.
Especially, where did we... Oh, you had him in Mexico, right?
When he went from second to 30th. And
fell off the planet.
He's done that twice on Sundays in the last year. So that can hurt a little bit, but...
Two other things.
Yes.
Masters.com coverage. Phenomenal. God, that was good. They got the featured group, the featured holes. shout out to masters.com, whoever is in charge of that. Talk to someone at PGA.com, right? Because PGA.com is shit compared to this coverage. It was on from first thing in the morning. Absolutely, it was awesome to watch. And I had it on all day yesterday too, with CBS on in the background, so mm-hmm. I don't have to watch all the bull crap. I actually get to watch the groups that I wanted,
right?
And the holes, and
guys,
so good.
Guys, whether you're at ESPN, CBS, NBC, don't cut into the middle of coverage with a 5-minute interview from somebody who just finished.
Or
their
put
round.
It in the bottom of the screen.
Yeah, a little corner. I can hear.
I can
them
hear it.
Speaking,
yeah, that's all I need.
While I'm watching them play, I mean, if you're watching an NFL game and they're into the second, say, the second quarter of the game you really want to watch that week, how excited are you, would you be if they just cut away for a 5-minute interview?
For a few plays,
from the noon game to the locker room. Here's Aaron Rodgers talking about his performance. They just would never do it in other sports.
No.
And yet somehow they do it in golf, and they think that the viewer, who really does want to see everything, is not going to be a little bit annoyed. So
finally, weekend golf made its debut on DraftKings, and I'm giving it thumbs up. I like it a lot. And I said that last week. I like the idea. I've been calling for it. I don't know what took so long for it to come along, but I really like it a lot. It gives people who... You know, and last week there weren't a lot of guys who missed the cut, so not a lot of lineups were ruined. But those weeks where lineups are just shot by some guys missing the cut, it's another chance for people to play DFS. And I think it's really good. I will say it's extremely high variance because there's no finishing points. It's just all based on scoring.
First to 2,000th, the difference is like 10, 15 points.
And especially in an event like the Masters where birdies are hard to come by, the difference is razor thin. And then when Matt Kuchar hits the hole-in-one, I think in the weekend format, I hate the hole-in-one bonus, which is just a joke. It ruined the contest.
It's an atrocity, and it happens every year at the Masters.
They got to get rid of it completely in weekend golf. Maybe put it what it is in weekend for the regular contests. But
just give them an eagle.
Right. Oh, that's enough. Yeah.
That's all that it's worth. It's not worth more than that. There's no bonus points on the actual course itself.
No.
So
no, it's stupid. But I like the weekend golf.
I think we were onto some pretty good ideas overall. And I wrote up a column late Friday night, just going through it with Jeff, going through it with Statboy, Eric, putting together our model and coming out. And I think there are some definite techniques. We're not going to get too deep into there because we do want to save a lot of that material for our subscribers
premium
that
members.
Are out there. But we did have kind of a 4-part process on things that you can start to look at after the cut on Friday in order to help give you at least a little bit of an edge over the rest of the field.
So. That's all for the Masters. Let's move on to... You look so sad.
I know. I am, because you look forward to that tournament.
I know. It is hard to
all year, and having been there last year and seeing it this year on TV, you see things so much differently on the course. Terms of how they're playing their shots, how the greens are working. I mean, it was a neat experience to be there and then to watch it this year. It was a lot of fun. And now we're, 51 weeks away from going back again. So, hey.
RBC Heritage this week. And it's one of my favorite, actually, events. I like it a lot. I like the course a lot. It's Harbortown. Golf Links. I wish it wasn't the week following the Masters. They'd get better players there. But also, it's a short course. It's one of the shortest all year. It's 7,099 yards, par 71. It's a precision course, an accuracy course. So you're not going to see hardly any bombers even show up to play here. They want no part of it.
I don't think
they
would show up regardless of the time of year.
Well,
there wouldn't be.
No, I agree with you. Yeah.
Unless they're RBC.
They don't want to play this. Right. Yeah. Tons of trees, narrow fairways, small greens.
Smallest on the tour for me.
Yep. It's kind of fun to watch. Key stats this week, strokes gained tee to green, birdie or better, strokes gained putting, scrambling, driving accuracy, and short iron game. Short iron proximity is really key. Putting's a little bit easier. Because the greens aren't going to be as slick, obviously, as Augusta, but as a lot of places. So I'm looking at guys who are accurate, both off the tee and into the green, guys who can hit the green, get themselves into play,
proximity,
get themselves putting quickly.
Yeah.
So let's break down the field. Up top, you got the guy who this sets up perfectly, doesn't it? After his hole-in-one, his big rally on Sunday, Matt Kuchar coming to play. RBC guy.
He's won here before.
He's played phenomenal here.
I'd love to be able to own him in cash, but just for the price tag.
It's a hefty $11,500 price tag.
The price tag and for the field that's here, I don't think I can pay up for him in cash. I'll still, I think you have to think about this week, too, with the Masters being last weekend. Because last year, coming out of the Masters, you know, a couple guys that looked great on paper, for me at least, Brant Snedeker, Paul Casey, both had just recorded top 10 finishes at Augusta.
Yep. I
thought, perfect.
Yep.
They're looking good.
A lot of momentum.
Pretty good history here. Let's go with these guys. Bang, they both missed the cut. Mm-hmm. So there is an exhaustion factor.
Okay.
Like there is for us physically and emotionally. It's the same for these guys too. I mean, I think Snedeker, I think he's an RBC guy.
He is an RBC guy.
Probably got a contract that says,
yeah,
you will be playing here this weekend.
Oh, absolutely.
Sir.
There are a few RBC guys. Him, Kuchar, who else? Adam Hadwin, Graham McDowell.
Graham DeLette.
Maybe DeLette. Oh, so. Luke Donald, obviously.
Yeah, this is his course. Yeah, so he's going to be mandated to be here. But a lot of those guys, you're going to have to take like a little bit of a second look just to see, all right, is there going to be any exhaustion from them? No, I think for some of these guys, it probably won't be as big of a deal. Kuchar's pretty consistent. I mean, week in, week out, he shows up, he plays his A game. There's not a lot of weeks. Well, Houston, I guess he kind of kicked it in down there.
But yeah, he did.
For the most part, he shows up, he plays his game.
Mm-hmm.
He does reasonably well. I probably won't play him in cash. I think GPP, I'll definitely be using him because he seems like he's a lock pretty much for a top 25 at least. And you know that he can contend here as well. Look in town a little bit. Boy, Russell Henley's stock has kind of gone through
the roof.
10-7 seems excessive. It's starting to seem pretty... I mean, for him to hit value as the second highest priced guy, you have to feel like it's really likely for him to be in the top 10. And his game certainly has gone up a level this year, but I don't think that, at least when I'm looking at it, the probabilities of him being a top 10 guy don't outweigh that for a lot of the other guys in that range. So I definitely won't be playing him in cash up there at the top either. Maybe I'll have some shares of GPP, but he probably won't be a guy that makes it into my core.
What do you think ownership's going to look like up top?
It's tricky. I think Kuchar probably will collect all that.
I think he probably will be the
highest.
He's
got a big name.
Yep.
He's been in the top 10 the last 3 years. He has a win here. So I think he's going to be a name that does collect quite a few shares.
I think it's going to be Kuchar, Snedeker, and Kisner up top here, I think, will be the most popular.
It's tough to overlook Grace for what he's done. And last year, Grace came in here after he had missed the cut at Augusta, and he won. And he's been in the top 10 here for the last couple years. This is a much different course than Augusta, and he actually was playing pretty well. So I think there is some merit to going back to the former champion there, because his game looked a little bit rough by about like last summer and into the fall.
Yep.
It seems like it's rebounded a little bit now again, so I think he could go back to Grace. But for just the fact that he's a South African player that doesn't necessarily get a lot of press or a lot of notice to the novice player around here, he probably will be a guy who still does get a little bit overlooked.
Yeah, I think his ownership won't be as high. It just never is for him.
No, and I can see Kisner still being fairly high, although he's starting to get up there in price now too, where it's 9,700. Is his upside consistently going to be top 10, top 15 all season? What is it? You're going to have a lot of decisions to make this week because there is that upper tier is gone and that upper middle group has kind of replaced that at the top in terms of pricing. So, looking into that 9,000 range, is there anybody who stands out for you that you will be looking at as kind of a core play this week?
Well, I think it might be interesting to see what Ty Hatton's ownership is going to do coming off his just abomination at the Masters. God, he looked absolutely dreadful.
He was all out of sorts. He was knocking his bag over. He's a temperamental guy.
Lost his cool. It'll be interesting to see because obviously his track record coming into last week was lights out.
Everybody
even on
owned
American
him last
soil.
Week in GPP and in cash. So that the disappointment factor,
right.
Probably pretty good. I think he's in for a bounce back week.
I think so.
He had a couple days to, if you look at Grace last year missed at the Masters.
Yep, he did.
And then he bounced back and won the following week. So having those extra couple days, I think, will be helpful for him coming in. I think he's a good play. Martin Kaymer has just been playing great everywhere he's been. And I was really surprised at how he looked at the Masters because he started out a little bit rough and then roared back for the rest of the weekend. And the Masters, he typically really struggles around the greens.
Yep.
And he looked pretty good. Was it his best finish ever at Augusta?
I think so.
If it wasn't, it was very close to being his best finish.
He just shows glimpses of how talented he is sometimes.
Right.
And yesterday or Sunday was just a showcase of his skills and how good he can be. And for weekend guys who had him, he was huge. You know, he crushed on weekend DK along with Kuchar. I'm okay with him here. I think that might be a decent GPP option because I don't think he's going to be heavily owned up top at 9,500. I think the other guys are going to draw the attention, and then people are going to drop down in that 7K range.
I'm thinking Bill Haas at 91.
He'll be popular.
Soak up a lot of ownership.
Yep.
Are we finally going to be having to get used to paying a lot of money for Adam Hadwin? Because I think this is another event where
he's up to 8,800. Yeah.
This should be another event where he shows up and plays well, but
yep.
It's tough when he was 6,900, 6,800, 7,000 range. Well, now he's close to 9,000. Is he still going to have the same? I think he can still make cuts for us pretty consistently, so I'm still feeling favorable towards him in cash.
Yep.
Can he deliver the same upside GPP? I think he can this week at this course. I think it really suits his game well. The approach game for him is much improved. The putter is there. He did struggle a little bit in overall with Augusta as far as, you know, having a lot of those bogey holes. But if you look at what he did yesterday to finish out, I think he had like 7 birdies in the final round. It was another huge weekend play. So I think a lot of that with Augusta was just seeing the course for the first time, being
probably
there, playing it for that first week. He had never played on there before.
Yep.
So he did get through the cut. He did score a decent amount of points for value. But, yeah, I mean, Augusta did catch up with him a little bit. But I still like the play this week. I like everything that I'm seeing in terms of the progression that he's made throughout the season, even already having the win under his belt. So
drop down to the 8K range, even if you want to drop into the 7K range. The guy who I think will attract the most attention and his track record kind of speaks for itself is Luke Donald. And he's only 7,800.
I was scrolling down. I'm like,
I know.
Did he drop out of the tournament? Like, oh, my God.
Why we do this.
They have him in the 7,000s this week. Well, I think that's an easy cash game play for
sure. Yeah, for sure.
All your lineups, just put them in on cash games and just run with it. We don't do that a lot, but I think it's a pretty reasonable play.
I'm not doing it in all my cash.
If he screws you, he screws you. Nope. I'm willing to live with that. So I'm okay there. I'll even have him in GPP. I don't know that I'll have him as a core because I think he will be very, very heavily owned. But yeah, I mean, it's a great course for him. It sets up really well. And I think in that 8,000 range, another guy who's been really good all season so far, Jason Duffner, 8,500. That is another core cash game play for me this week and will be as long as he keeps making cuts the way that he has. You know, it's really been impressive with Duffner this season is that typically the last few years it's been his putter that's let him down.
Yep.
And this season he's actually been able to putt consistently pretty well. I thought he maybe would fall back a little bit at Augusta. He didn't. He hung in there. And he's looked sharp all season. He's been great for us in cash games. So I like Donald and Duffner will be two guys that I think you can start most of your cash games.
I think this course fits Duffner so well, and I liked him so much last year, and he really let me down. And when you look at his tournament history, it's not very good here.
No, it's marginal, but he doesn't miss cuts.
No, he doesn't miss cuts. I just feel like his game fits here so much better than he has shown in the past. And I don't know, maybe that's something about coming off of Augusta the week prior. You know, that could be part of it.
The other guy that I will build around a lot for cash and could potentially even be more for GPP will be Pat Perez. 8,100.
Okay.
He's back this year.
Is
he? He's better than ever. I mean, he's got a nice course history here overall. The price, I think, is very fair. He looked great last week at Augusta. I mean, that's not necessarily a course where you think Augusta,
Pat Perez,
right? And he just sneakily kind of hung around the entire weekend, much the same way he has all season. I mean, the only time he's really let us down was when he had to withdraw.
When I loaded up on him.
When you loaded up on him. I
hate that guy.
But, I mean, overall, he's a top 20 finish at Augusta.
Yeah.
So that shows you that the game is on.
Quietly, too.
Right.
That was a quiet top 20.
Right. If you look back at the end of the weekend, you're like, wait a minute, was Pat Perez even here?
I know.
We didn't even see him. I don't think we saw one shot of Pat Perez on TV the entire time.
That could be sneaky this week.
So I think for me, that's going to be a big GPP play, and that's definitely a cash game must as far as what I'm looking at. So I think Duffner, Perez, Donald, if you start a lot of your cash games around those three guys right there, you still have a ton of money left over to work higher than that from there. So, those are all guys right in that mid-range that I like quite a bit. The one guy I want to ask you about before we get any lower than that.
Yes.
This guy who suddenly found himself struggling a little bit the last couple weeks.
Okay.
Cabrera Bayo.
Yeah, he's my guy,
RCB,
too.
Man.
It's so frustrating.
Yeah.
He's been out of sorts. He looked like poo-poo platter last week at the Masters.
I mean, he looked so bad in Houston. We could just see he's in the middle of the fairway. great tee shot, and then 100 yards out, and then he's hitting it into the water.
And this is not a good place if you're not hitting.
If your game is a little bit off, that can be dangerous, but he's at a nice price. What is he price? He's in the
7,800. I know, he stood out to me because I usually am all in on him.
So he just crushed people the last couple weeks. So the bandwagon is empty. The horse is just flying away.
You think he won't be under 10% owned though, will he?
Maybe not under 10.
10 to 13.
But I mean,
if you get him at
10, you're kind of that's under owned.
Yeah.
You know, for an event like this in the field that's this soft. I mean, this could be the opportunity after he's missed two straight cuts. I mean, it's a completely different course now too. So.
Absolutely, I'll consider it. There's guys I will say that I like a lot better than him, especially in that price range.
Yeah.
But I'll consider it. I'll have to look at his stats and everything.
I think it's a buying opportunity. If he just blows the third cut in a row, I guess then we got to pull a Russell Knox and start thinking about it. Which,
speaking of,
good transition too, is he's got an excellent course history. When you think of a course that would fit a player, Russell Knox
right here.
I mean, as far as being, he's a shorter hitter, but he's very accurate. He drills greens, but he has been doing neither of those things.
He's
so
been
far
awful
this season. And if he hasn't elevated it someplace else in terms of his putting, I don't know what to do with the guy. I mean, he's missed cuts in 4 of 5 events, and the one place where he didn't miss a cut was a no-cut event where he finished 70th. So, and the match play that didn't work out. So I mean, it's
funny how guys can just hit walls. Yeah, like he was just rolling in the fall.
He was the guy.
Yeah,
he was the guy. Everything was working in his game. We were looking at God, what is this guy's odds for the Masters?
I know.
Let's get some early money in before his odds get up there too.
Right.
God, we could have had him at the Masters for about $200. So by the time the thing closed, and we still wouldn't have been interested in the least.
No.
You know, the one thing I did like about Knox is that we did get to see him in the feature group a little bit on Friday before the cut line,
mm-hmm.
and he was out of the mix. He was probably like plus 11, plus 12,
mm-hmm.
and he birdied 3 or 4 holes there near the end to get him, I think, back to like plus 8 or something like that. It wasn't incredible, but I liked the fact that, I mean, there's two directions you can go. You can go the Hatton direction and just
throw your clubs,
knock your bag over, not even attempt to try to get a birdie the rest of the way. Or you can fight like Russell Knox did. I think that means something. You know, you saw it even a little bit yesterday with a guy like Spieth.
Mm-hmm.
He hits it into the water on 12. He's struggling. There's nothing left that he has to really do or try for. He gets back. He's plus 2. He's plus 6 on the day. Who cares, right? Let's just kick it in.
Yep.
Well, you know what? He finishes with 3 out of 4 birdies on the last 4 holes. He gets himself back to minus 1. He's in respectable territory, and I mean, he ends up plus 3 for the round, but
he's got some pride.
You see some fight, and I saw a little bit of fight on a Knox, so I don't think that's enough to make him into a core play for me this week. But if you're looking for a guy who could wake up from the dead, who's not going to be very highly owned at all this week, that would be a guy with maybe just a tiny bit of potential, but no more than like 5% shares, I would say.
Integrity, pride. I think Henrik Stenson.
Of course. He had another rough run last week.
Dropping down to the low 7s, 6K range. Prices go all the way down to 6,400 this week, yet there's no one down in that low 6,000 range that I will have any exposure to, I don't think.
There really aren't even a lot of guys that I look at in the lower 7K range that I love.
Grayson Murray.
Yeah, I mean, he's
just keep talking on Twitter, buddy.
He's another guy.
Keep talking.
Should give him some lessons, right?
That's right.
How to be popular and win friends over on Twitter.
Right.
You know, there's probably only one guy there in the lower 7K range that I'll have him in cash, maybe a little bit for GPP, Stuart Sink. This guy's been incredibly consistent over the last 2 months. If you look at his finishes, he's 27th or 28th for 4 straight events. I think he was like cracked the top 25. In the last event, he was 23rd, 22nd, somewhere in that range. He's got a pretty good track record here.
Hits greens, murders greens.
That's huge. He is the GIR machine.
Yep.
So he is a guy at 7,100. He's definitely a guy you can play in cash and feel pretty comfortable about it if you stack him with the other 3 guys that we went over. That gives you a nice amount of room to pick from a couple of guys in the 9K range.
Yep.
Up at the top. Is there anybody down here that you're
I'll throw out a couple of names. How about Rafael Campos?
Yeah. I mean, the Puerto Rican, he's just going to keep showing up as long as he gets into the top 10, right? Yeah, so this is the third, awesome. This is the third one.
Love
now.
It.
You know, he wrote it in Puerto Rico and then in Houston. And, you know, I like that story a little
I
bit.
Too.
I'm not going to go there for cash. Obviously, it's a little bit of a silly play, but
not doing that.
I think in GPP, he's still going to be underexposed. People don't really know a lot about him. They've casually seen him if they played Puerto Rico, if they played much in Houston. So you're still going to get a guy who's probably at like 2% owned or so.
Oh, yeah.
So if you're at 5%, you're ahead of the field.
Yep.
You've got him when nobody else does. One other guy in the 7K range that we didn't mention that I will definitely be owning this week will be Patrick Cantlay.
Yeah.
He's shown the amateur talent that he had a few years ago. It's a great story. It looks like he's over his back injuries finally. Super talented player. We saw what he can do, almost winning at the Valspar a few weeks ago. He's 3-for-3 making the cut this season. And he's still fairly priced.
And overall. Not as much chatter about him this week.
Yeah, it should be down a little because, I mean, he took second and then he was like 39th. So
right.
people are going to own him.
Yep.
But it's not going to be huge. It might be like 8 to 10% or so, which I'm fine with. That means I don't have to go all in on. I can still buy 10% or 15% in a GPP and have a pretty fair weight on that.
Anyone else that you want to mention while we're at it?
I think that's a lot of names.
Okay.
I don't want to give any more names.
All right. Check our articles out. I do a hardcore core. Perry's got his preview up. Zachary does the daily spin. Adam does a phenomenal job with the first tee.
He made his debut last week. I thought it was awesome. I thought he did a really good job. So if you guys
great writing
haven't read Adam Daly yet, it's really good stuff.
Very good. We also have a European event. The European Tour is back.
Oh, the trophy is on two?
Yes. The two. Yep. The deuce. We won't talk about it right now, but check out. We got Perry's got his article
Perry
up on
David.
The site now.
Yeah.
Yep. David will do his targets, and I'll do my core on the European. High variance, but gives you something to do like early morning hours on
like
Thursday.
5-6 hours ahead. So if you were up late at night at like 2-3 in the morning like I usually am,
you follow it.
It gives you something
to watch.
It's
pretty fun.
Yeah, exactly.
And we, you know, if you want to join our European Tour package, do that. It's available in the, is it available in the Pro Pack?
Yes.
The European. It is. Okay.
Absolutely.
Or you can just add it on to your FGI subscription as well. If you have any questions for us, we're always available at info@fantasygolfinsider.com. Best of luck this week with the RBC Heritage, and we will talk to you next week.
Good luck.